today on Word of Grace Radio with senior pastor and teacher, Joe Marquez.
Verses 18 and 19 says, "But someone will say, 'You have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works.' You believe that God is one? You do well. Even the demons believe and shudder." So there's demonic faith, faith that believes that there's a God. Do the demons believe there's a God? Absolutely. Many of them have been there. Do they know what he can do? Absolutely. But if they surrendered their heart to him? No. It's demonic belief. Then there's not only demonic faith, but there's dead faith, right? Faith without works is what? Dead. It's not alive. It's not a living faith. And then there's maybe dynamic faith, faith that's alive and living and growing and maturing. You see, Jesus doesn't just want you to believe in him for what he can do, but he wants you to take that next step to where you trust him for not just for what he can do, but mainly for who he is.
Your word of grace offers healing to the nation. Stronghold. Your word of grace sets the captive free. Oh, it will strengthen the believer and gives us power to
Welcome to Word of Grace, a radio ministry of Grace Calvary Chapel, located in San Antonio, Texas. We pray that God uses these sermons to bless, encourage, and help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Today, Pastor Joe is in the book of John, chapter 2, verses 23 through 25. The title of his sermon is, "That You Might Truly Believe in Jesus." Here is the first half of the sermon with senior pastor and teacher, Joe Marquez.
This three verses could be entitled, "They believed in Jesus, but Jesus did not believe in them. They believed in him, but he didn't believe in them." Why? Because he knew what was in their heart. And so they had superficial belief. They had what Warren Wiersbe called, they were unsaved believers. Unsaved believers. And as we go through this, you'll understand a little better. But let's look at verse 23, superficial belief. "Now, when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover feast, many believed in his name when they saw the signs that he was doing." The previous study in John, Jesus had gone into Jerusalem, and remember, he had overthrown tables and tossed out the money changers. He was upset. During Passover, you not only celebrated Passover, you celebrated the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And so you were there. He would have been there in Jerusalem for 8 days or so. And as we see here, Jesus was doing stuff. He had done, not only cast them out of the money changers and stuff, cast them out of the temple area, but he had also done many signs. And in fact, if you continued reading in John chapter 3, one of those who saw the signs was that Jesus was doing was Nicodemus. And in verses 1 and 2 of John chapter 3, it says, "Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, 'Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him.'" So Nicodemus saw some of the signs that Jesus was doing. We don't know exactly what those signs were. None of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John, tell us specifically what they were, what signs Jesus did while he was in Jerusalem at this specific time. But we can imagine that he would have been healing people. He would have been giving sight to the blind. He would have been allowing the lame to walk, and so on. When it says signs, it means a miraculous sign. So Jesus did many of these things while he was there in Jerusalem at the Passover feast. So he wasn't there just throwing over tables, right, and casting out the money changers. He was helping people. And the result of that is what the end of verse 23 tells us. Many believed in his name when they saw the signs that he was doing. Now, initially, as you read that verse, you think, oh, they came to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior. But it doesn't really say that. It just says many believed in his name. And so this belief was actually, as we look further at the scripture, it was actually a superficial belief. It was not grounded in who Jesus was, but rather in what Jesus could do. They believed in his name when they saw the signs that he was doing. And John uses that word sign, Simeon, in the Greek some 17 times. It means a miracle. We know if we look at all the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, there are 37 miracles recorded in the Gospel. And people look at miracles in different ways. Sometimes we respond to miracles, and when we do, we just consider them like everyday things. Some put it like we over-naturalize them. For example, maybe you're shopping at HEB and you get a front row parking and you tell yourself, man, it's a miracle. I got to park right in the front. Imagine it's Christmas season and you go to the mall and instead of doing Weight Watcher parking, you park right in the front, you know? And you get a space, you go, wow, it's a miracle. Or every time a baby is born, man, it's a miracle. Or me, when I came this morning and we pray at 8:15 and everybody's standing up holding hands, and I'm thinking, man, it's a miracle. That's the first time that ever happened. Usually people are sitting down, and I got to pry them away from their coffee and their whatever else they're eating. And, well, I won't say what I'm thinking, but yeah, it's a miracle. Praise the Lord. So we call everything a miracle. Well, those things aren't miracles, okay? They're not miracles. Sometimes people want to explain them away, however. They'll say, well, you know, when you really add science to it, this is the way it happened. So we can see it wasn't really a miracle. Just let me explain it to you scientifically. And there are even some Bible commentators who try to do that. You look at how the Israelites left Egypt, for example, and how they crossed over the Red Sea, right? And some will say, it wasn't really the Red Sea, it was the Reed Sea. And it was only 18 inches deep, and, you know, they really walked through it. It was like swampy. Yeah, it was wet, but they walked through it. And so you ask them, well, how did the Egyptians drown? Well, they drowned in 18 inches of water, obviously. Or Jonah in the whale, you know, or maybe, well, I should say big fish because, you know, it doesn't really say whale. Jonah and the big fish. I mean, how in the world can somebody get into a fish and, you know? Or how about Jesus feeding the 5,000? Well, he didn't really feed the 5,000. What happened is, everybody brought their lunch, but they didn't want to bring it out, you know? They wanted to keep it. And so this little kid who had the fish and the loaves of bread, he said, I'm going to bring out my lunch. And he brought out his lunch, and I'll share it with all 5,000 of you. And everybody else then brought out their lunch, and they had a big old potluck. And so we tried to explain away miracles, even people who read the Bible and comment on it. Third way, sometimes we hype miracles. We hype them, and the church does this. Certain television stations, you know, they'll preach, expect your miracle today, right? And if you send in a certain amount of money, you will receive your miracle today. And because people are hurting, right, especially if they're sick, they'll send in the $25, $50, or $100 so that they will be healed. And they'll do it again and again. And believe me, they know what they're doing. They raise enormous amounts of money to do that. No, we don't have miracle services, all right? We don't want to overhype them. But what is a miracle? Or what is a sign, a miraculous sign? A miracle, Webster calls it, an extraordinary event manifesting divine intervention in human affairs. Someone said it's a divine work wrought with divine power for a divine purpose. It's God intervening in the lives of people to touch them and to change them. You see, God is not a prisoner to his own laws, the laws that he, in fact, has established here on earth. You say, I didn't know there were laws. Yeah, there are laws. There's one called the law of gravity. You ever tried to get on top of the roof and try to fly off of it? Gravity, this law of gravity takes over. And so when you step off that roof, instead of flying, you actually fall down. And gravity takes you down. Gravity is so powerful. And when I went to the dentist the other day, my dentist told me, you know, one of your upper tooth is being pulled down by gravity. And I'm like, I never heard that before. You know, that's interesting. Not the bottom one. No, because the bottom one, gravity will suck them more in. No, the upper one is being pulled down. Wow, that's gravity is incredible. But we've learned how to overcome gravity, right? You allow air to pass over a foil, and you accompany that with thrust or propulsion, and what do you get? You get an airplane flying. And we see those. We see those big old C-35As flying over here over Lackland. And we're thinking, man, it looks like that thing's going to come down at any time, doesn't it? Big old giant plane just barely floating, and it looks like it's going to crash. And I'm just expecting one of these days, one of those things just to come down. I mentioned how to think of miracles yesterday during Louis' service, and I got the picture from somebody, and they said it's like this guy who had a train set in his basement. And you go in the basement, and the whole basement is one big old train set with tracks and little cities and little people. And he had a remote control where he controls the train. But every now and then, the train would fall off the track. And so this guy would step into train world and would get the train and would put it back on the track so that it was going the right way. Or he would change the people around. Or he would do something. And then he would step out of that world. And that's what God does when he performs a miracle. He steps into the life of a human being. And he touches them and he changes them. Sometimes physically. Many times spiritually. He's done that for many of us as he has given us the miracle of new birth in him. Therefore, if any man is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone. The new has come. And believe me, you've known enough Christians that you've seen some and you go, man, only Jesus could have done that, right? Because they're totally different. Some of the pastors will tell me about their lives previously. And one, Pastor Jim would tell me about when we would go to the pastor's retreat in Marietta, California. Calvary Chapel bought that facility there. It used to be a resort for the rich. And primarily for actors and stuff. And they had a spa there. And Pastor Jim used to go there in his BC days when it was a spa. And he goes, they used to have mud baths here. And I passed out one time in one of those mud baths. And they had to pull me out of there before I drowned in the mud. And I'm looking at him and going, really? He goes, yeah. And you would never think it, you know? Well, what happened? God changed his life. And so God does perform miracles. Why does he do them? Well, one, because he loves people, right? He loves people, and he doesn't love suffering. And two, he does them to prove who he is, that he is God, and that he's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think. But what happens is that sometimes people just look for one miracle after another, and their faith never gets beyond that. So that all they start doing is looking for one sign after another sign. You see, many believed in his name when they saw the signs that he was doing, but this faith wasn't the faith that leads them to salvation. You see, there's different types of belief. The Bible tells us this in James chapter 2, in verses 18 and 19. It says, but someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You believe that God is one? You do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. So there's demonic faith, faith that believes that there's a God. Do the demons believe there's a God? Absolutely. Many of them have been there. Do they know what he can do? Absolutely. But if they surrendered their heart to him? No. It's demonic belief. Then there's not only demonic faith, but there's dead faith, right? Faith without works is what? Dead. It's not alive. It's not a living faith. And then there's maybe dynamic faith. Faith that's alive and living and growing and maturing. You see, Jesus doesn't just want you to believe in him for what he can do, but he wants you to take that next step to where you trust him for not just for what he can do, but mainly for who he is. Creator of the universe. Maker of heaven and earth. Worthy of all of our praise and worship. Just for who he is. And people struggle with that. In John 8:30 and 31, as he was saying these things, speaking of Jesus, many believed in him. So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, if you abide in my word, truly you are my disciples. Or how about Simon the sorcerer in Acts chapter 8, verse 13. Even Simon himself believed, and after being baptized, he continued with Philip. And seeing signs and miracles performed, he was amazed. And down in Acts 8, verse 18, now when Simon saw that the Spirit was given through the laying of hands, the apostles' hands, he offered them money, saying, give me this power also, so that anyone in whom I lay my hands on may receive the Holy Spirit. And Peter said to him, may your silver perish with you, because you thought you could obtain the gift of God with money. You have neither part nor lot in this matter, for your heart is not right before God. Repent, therefore, of this wickedness of yours, and pray to the Lord that, if possible, the intent of your heart may be forgiven you. For I see that you are in the gall of bitterness and in the bond of iniquity. You see, what people want are signs. They weren't looking for a Savior. And signs will never be enough. Because what happens when your prayer is not answered? What happens when the sick person isn't healed? Or the person in prison isn't set free? Or the check doesn't come? What happens? Do you stop believing? That's superficial faith. That's faith based only on signs. No, when those things happen, you don't stop believing. You continue believing and praising the Lord because of who He is. Almighty God, maker of heaven and earth. And if all you're doing is believing for the sign, it's superficial belief. Jesus knew this. He had super intuition. In verse 24, it says, but Jesus on his part did not entrust himself to them. He did not believe them. Why? Because he knew all people. He knew what was in their heart. You know, the Bible tells us that we don't even know our heart. Our heart is deceitfully wicked. Who can know it? We can't even know our own heart. But Jesus does. Jesus knows everything about everything and about everyone. Everything. He knows every thought you have. He knows all the things you've done, all the good things and all the bad things. He knows it all. You might be able to hide it from people for a while. You know, you might be able to hide your visits to the porn sites and your whatever, all that other stuff that you're doing. You might be able to hide it, but you can never hide it to Jesus. You can never hide all the times you've cussed somebody out on the road, and you might not have said it out loud, right? You can't hide it. He already knows it. He sees it all. He knows it all. He knows every single thing about everything and about everyone. So he saw their heart, and he did not believe them. Or did not entrust himself to them. He saw that their faith was superficial. That the only reason they believed is because they saw him doing some miracle. And he knew their heart wasn't right. So he didn't believe in them. And you know, it's a difficult thing. Because, I mean, we want to bless people. We want to benefit them, right? During Christmas, you have Operation Christmas Child. And all the gift boxes. I mean, you want to bless people with clothes or with food or whatever. And you know, having gone on many missionary trips, having done that, shoot, you start passing out food, people will come, or clothes, they'll come in droves. You give an altar call, everybody raises their hand, you know? But then you really wonder, what type of belief is that? Is it real or is it just superficial? And we know there are many who know the system, know the church. I've known people in during Thanksgiving, they'll end up with 5 or 6 turkeys because they just go from one church to another that's passing them out. I mean, there they are. Their trunk is filled with turkeys. And they don't eat them all. They sell them, right? And so Jesus understood this. But he still ministered to them. He still fed them. He still wanted to bless them. So why didn't they believe? Well, they had a rocky heart. And in Matthew 13, the parable of the sower, in verses 1 and 9, it says, that same day Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea, and great crowds gathered around him so that he got into a boat and sat down. And the whole crowd stood on the beach, and he told them many things in parables, saying, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell along the path, and the birds came and devoured them. Or other seeds fell on rocky ground where they did not have much soil, and immediately they sprang up since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose and they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and produced grain, some 100, some 60, some 30. He who has ears, let him hear. And the disciples, when they heard that, they had no idea what Jesus was talking about. So he explained it to them. In verse 18 of Matthew 13, Jesus said, "Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what has been sown in his heart. This is what was sown along the path. And as for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy, yet he has no root in himself, but endures for a while. And when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately he falls away. As for that which was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the word of the world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and it becomes unfruitful. As for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it. He indeed bears fruit. In one case, 100, another case, 60, another case, 30. So two questions. Have you committed your life to Christ? And number two, has Christ committed his life to you? Maybe you've raised your hand and said, "I believe in Jesus," but does Jesus believe you? He knows your heart. You see, he knew all people. The end of verse 24. He knew the Samaritan woman. Remember when he went to her and they started talking and Jesus tells her how many husbands she had, and then he goes, "And the one you're living with now is not your husband." He knows. He knew Simon Peter when he first saw him. And for some reason, he still left him on the team, right? He knew Nathaniel. See, he knows all of us. You see, Jesus has this superior knowledge, or as I said, he's omniscient. He knows all things. He knows everything. And in verse 25, it says, "And no one and needed no one to bear witness about man, for he himself knew what was in man." So when you pray and you say, "Jesus, you know this person?" The answer is, yes, he does. Do you know what they're doing? Yes. Do you know how they're thinking? Yes. He doesn't need anyone to tell him. He already knows it. He already sees it. And I realize we pray sometimes as if he doesn't. If you only knew. No, he does know. He does know. He knows how you're feeling, what you're thinking, all of that stuff. And I know we'll continue to inform him, though he already knows. He doesn't need anyone to bear witness about man, for he himself knew what was in man. As Hebrews 4:13 says, "No creature is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give account." Nothing is ever secret. It's all open scandal in heaven. God sees all and knows all. He knows it. So he didn't trust these people. He knew what was in their heart. He knew that they were only after one sign after another. But then why did he still do signs? Well, because there are some people who eventually would believe. Nicodemus, as we turn the page next week and look at John chapter 3, Nicodemus saw some of the signs. And that's why he went to Jesus, and Jesus fed his faith where Nicodemus finally believed, truly believed, not superficially, not just for signs. So as we look at our faith, look at how we believe. Do we believe in Jesus just for what he can do? And then do we stop believing when he doesn't do what we think he should do? Because we'll so often we'll pray, "Lord, my will be done, not yours. Get behind my will." When what we should be praying, "Lord, your will be done," whatever that may be. And we lose sight of the fact that this world is temporary, that there's going to be what? Trouble and tribulation that's been promised to us. In this world, we will have tribulation. So when it comes, it's just the promise God has fulfilled again. So why do we believe? Why do we trust? Why do we worship? Because of who he is, Almighty God.
Thank you so much, Pastor Joe. Well, that concludes today's study in the book of John, chapter 2, verses 23 through 25. The title of this sermon is, "That You Might Truly Believe in Jesus." If you'd like to access this sermon, or find out about church service times, maybe even submit a prayer request, or get in contact with Pastor Joe directly, you can do all of this through our church website at gracecalvarychapel.org. Well, Grace Calvary Chapel would love to invite you to come out to visit any of our services. Our Sunday service is at 8:30 a.m. and 11 a.m. We also have Sunday School, which is our Grace Groups, at 10 a.m. Our Wednesday night Bible study starts at 7:35 p.m. So if you would like to get more information about our fellowship or connect with us on social networks, or even make a financial contribution to Word of Grace Radio, you can access our website at gracecalvarychapel.org, or you can call us at 210-675-2120. That number again is 210-675-2120. Well, Senior Pastor and Teacher Joe Marquez and Grace Calvary Chapel would like to thank you for taking time to listen to our broadcast. It has truly been a blessing for our church. So until next time, we pray that the Lord would richly bless you with His Word of Grace.